Good evening, everyone. My name is Rabbi Susan Nanus, Director of Adult Programs at Wilshire Boulevard Temple, and on behalf of all our clergy and congregants, we welcome you to our temple this evening. Wilshire Boulevard Temple is the oldest temple in Los Angeles. It was founded in 1864, and we have a long history of interfaith and intercultural relationships, and we are proud to be hosting this program this evening. So without further ado, I'd like to have you all welcome Dan Schnur, the president of the American Jewish Committee and sponsor of this program.
Thank you, Rabbi Nanus, and thank you also to Rabbi Stephen Leder and to the entire team here at Wilshire Boulevard Synagogue for being willing to host us here this evening. As Rabbi Nanus mentioned, my name is Dan Schnur, and I'm the director of the Los Angeles region for the American Jewish Committee. And I'm thrilled to be here tonight, not just on behalf of our own community, but for the first in what we plan to be a series of cross-community conversations about issues of critical importance to the entire Los Angeles region and the various communities that make up the Los Angeles region. We're co-sponsoring tonight's program as the first in a three-part series on immigration and refugee policy. And we're co-sponsoring this program along with our friends at the Mexican American Legal Defense and Education Foundation. And our good friends at the Center for Asians United for Self-Empowerment. Thank you very much to our friends at CAUSE. And what this partnership signifies to us, even beyond this three-part discussion about the critical issues of immigration and refugee policy, are two things. Number one, a recognition that the challenges that any one of our communities face is a challenge that we all face. And if we're going to overcome those challenges, we're going to overcome them together. So with our friends at CAUSE and with our friends at MALDEF, with our friends representing the entire range of racial and religious and ethnic freedom in the greater Los Angeles area, we're thrilled to be bringing you tonight's discussion. And what we ask of you tonight, both in this discussion and in our other programs following later this year, is know that we very specifically and very consciously put together a panel, put together a group of conversants that represent a wide and broad range of opinions and insights on these critical issues important to us. So this evening, when we talk not just about immigration and refugee policy, but when we talk about the very specific challenge of what needs to be done, what is being done, and what must still be done to keep our immigrant communities safe, you're going to hear a range of perspectives and a range of insights. And what we ask in advance is that you remember that the way a community truly comes together is when it respectfully talks and respectfully listens and comes to common agreement about how to most effectively take on these challenges. In the future, later this year, after the Supreme Court acts, we will bring this group together again to talk about the issue of refugee policy. And toward the end of this year, or early in 2018, we'll do a third conversation on the challenges that particularly exist for those who come to this country seeking asylum. We all know, whether Latino, whether Asian Pacific, whether Muslim, whether Jewish, regardless of your heritage, we know what it's like, ourselves, our parents, our grandparents, to come to this country, to come to this incredible place of Los Angeles at tremendous risk in order to provide a better future for ourselves, for our children, and for their children. So we're thrilled to be part of this conversation tonight. And I'm going to step aside for just a couple minutes before we begin the panel, because in just a minute you're going to hear from a gentleman who understands these challenges possibly better than anyone else in the state of California, our extraordinary Mayor Eric Garcetti. But in the meantime, I'd like to bring up someone who I hold in extremely high regard as well, the leader of the American Jewish Committee in the Los Angeles region, our president, my friend Scott Edelman. Scott, thank you so much.
Good evening. Tonight's discussion is about law enforcement and their relationship with the communities that they serve. But before we delve into that discussion, we should talk for a moment about the news of the day. AJC has been active in the coalition of religious and civic groups that supported DACA from the start. And we have urged Congress to enact legislation extending DACA or making it permanent. Earlier this year, AJC commended the Trump administration for leaving the program in place, at least for a time. Today, we want to remind communities across the world where AJC stands on this issue. Dismantling DACA is a devastating blow to hundreds of thousands of young people who have benefited from the program and who have in turn contributed to communities across the country in which they live. Few issues impact our city and its communities as much as the issue of immigration, especially since Los Angeles is a bastion of diversity and one of only two cities that has a majority-minority population. Los Angeles County is arguably the most ethnically and culturally diverse region in the world and has the largest undocumented population in the country. In light of current federal policy changes, these immigrant communities are heavily impacted, not only because of direct actions that jeopardize their stability with the threat of deportation, but also the sense of fear and uncertainty as to what may lay ahead. What further exacerbates the situation are the challenges this reality creates for law enforcement, whose primary role is to serve and to protect. But the imminent threat of deportation has eroded the trust of immigrant communities on whom they rely for reporting crimes and assisting in public safety. Why AJC cares? AJC has a long-standing history of working to advance human rights, which began at its outset 111 years ago, aiding Jews fleeing persecution. This work was then amplified and expanded to address not only anti-Semitism, but the rights and protection of other immigrant communities, both locally and globally. For years, AJC has been pushing for comprehensive immigration reform at the federal level. More recently, AJC has ramped up its advocacy efforts in supporting DACA and the Bridge Act and making these key policy priorities for its National Latino Jewish Leadership Council. As Jews, we know intimately the experiences of living as immigrants and within diaspora communities. We have an in-depth understanding of the promises and the pitfalls of the immigration process. The story of coming to the United States with the hope of building a better life is also our story. So why is it critical to have diverse partners in grappling with this issue? Our community is not alone in confronting issues of hate and discrimination that tend to go side by side with drastic immigration policy. And if we have taken lessons from the Jewish story, it is that we need other communities and diverse partners to advance our common goals and our shared values. Ultimately, we understand that the wealth of a nation is the diverse parts of its whole. This is the pluralistic and inclusive nature of the United States and what makes us unique in this world. E pluribus unum, out of many, one. Our hope is that this forum provides the space for dialogue between the impacted communities you represent and those who serve them, so that in the end, we are better positioned today than we were yesterday. And now it is my pleasure to introduce Mayor Garcetti. Mayor Eric Garcetti was first elected to the Los Angeles City Council in 2001. He served as council president from 2006 to 2012, and he has been our mayor since 2013. Mayor Garcetti has a long-standing commitment to immigrants in Los Angeles. As a city council member, he proposed establishing an Office of Immigrant Affairs, and upon becoming mayor, he immediately began utilizing that office to advance the well-being of our immigrant communities. Mayor Garcetti also strongly supports the police department's long-standing policy with respect to immigration enforcement, which are rooted in the principle that all of Los Angeles is safer when the police department maintains a relationship of trust and cooperation with all city residents. Recently, the mayor led a bipartisan nationwide effort to defend DACA against potential elimination. Joined by 60 mayors from across the country, Mayor Garcetti, as chair of the United States Conference of Mayors Latino Alliance, called upon the White House to abandon any idea of repealing DACA and urged Congress to pass comprehensive immigration reform. At the mayor's DACA National Day of Action, which took place on August 29th, the mayor said, "Keeping all of Los Angeles's neighborhoods safe means working relentlessly to build trust between police and the people they serve. The LAPD will never act as a federal immigration force, and I am committed to finding new ways we can reinforce that policy so that fewer people live in fear." Last but not least, Mayor Garcetti is a great friend of AJC. He signed AJC Mayors United Against Anti-Semitism campaign. By signing that statement, United States mayors and municipal leaders pledge to advance respectful coexistence in their own communities and urge their European counterparts to affirm that anti-Semitism is incompatible with fundamental democratic values. Mayor Garcetti.
Thank you so much, Scott, and good evening. This is a day, a dark day, for this nation and for this city. This is a day in which this city, which in so many ways is the embodiment and the face of what this nation will be and what this world is today. We saw, despite the work that we have all done to come together, a day which was, I don't know how else to say it, un-American. I spent most of the day with dreamers today, as I have so many days. The rally downtown and our press conference. There was one girl whose experience I wanted to share with you this evening, Yamilex. She said, "I am here, President Trump. You didn't have the courage to stand in front of a podium today, to tell me the news of what you were going to do to me. But I am unafraid. I'm unbending. I will claim my American dream." And as she, the daughter of immigrants here, said, "My mother didn't ask for my father to be killed in Guatemala. My mother didn't ask for me to come to this country. She didn't ask for Congress to fail over and over to pass a Dream Act. All she did was make sure that I was safe and could survive. It's something that had a lot of resonance for me, and I want to thank the AJC for what you are doing here this evening, because I literally wouldn't be here if it wasn't for a similar story myself. We didn't have the term back then, but my grandfather Salvador was a dreamer, carried over the border by my bisabuela, my great-grandmother. During the Mexican Revolution, when my great-grandfather was also killed in war, she didn't think about whether or not the United States had the right laws or what she could do in Mexico. She grabbed her child and crossed the border with him in her arms. And that dreamer, Salvador, came here and grew up and only knew this country, the United States of America. He grew up in Boyle Heights, never finished the eighth grade. In fact, once when I was spending the night at his house, I used to go over there with my sister on the weekends, we were watching the television and a very distinguished man was on TV. And he said, "I know him. He's the mayor of Los Angeles, Tom Bradley." And I couldn't believe that my grandfather, a humble man who worked as a barber until he could save up enough money to open up his own shop in South LA, knew the mayor of Los Angeles. And I said, "Grandpa, how do you know him?" And he said, "Well, when I was younger and he was younger, he arrested me." And I don't know if it was an act by an LAPD officer, Chief Frank, that changed that young man's life, or maybe falling in love with my grandmother Juanita, who was one of 19 children born to two Mexican immigrants who came over the border from Sonora in Mexico as well. But he decided in World War II, because he was undocumented, to volunteer to fight and potentially die for this country. And he went off in World War II, got his citizenship, and came back here. As a result of that, I stand here today. I stand here too because of Jews who fled oppression, forced conscription in the Russian Empire, people who picked up everything they had. And this country has always been the place, and this city in particular, a fertile ground where we don't ask you for your papers when you come here. We don't ask you how you worship God. We don't ask you what language your parents speak or whom you love. We don't care what your income is. We don't care the color of your skin. We care whether you buy into the idea that you can make a life here and contribute. I guess I care too much about families to let today's actions go unanswered. The idea that we are an America that will separate parents from children. I guess I listen too much to our police professionals to stop listening to what they say when we say that LAPD will never be an immigration enforcement force. And not only is Special Order 40 there, but we have strengthened it through an executive action and now through police commission action just in recent weeks to make sure we are not collaborating with a federal government that is going after now otherwise innocent children of America. That's what I call our dreamers. Children of America, because this is where they grew up. This is who they are. And so to make sure that we are not complicit in what this administration is doing now, thanks for the words, but it is time for Congress to act. When you see Orrin Hatch say, "I believe in dreamers," and Speaker Ryan say, "I want to make sure that they are here," thank you for the words. It is time now to act. And with a Republican president, they've had an opportunity when George W. Bush was pushing forward comprehensive immigration reform. And they had a chance with Barack Obama, who only used the tool of DACA because nothing was passing legislatively. So I don't feel actually depressed right now. I feel strong. I feel strong backed by the picture I saw today of dreamers willing to do what our president wouldn't and confront their futures and to speak and to come out of the shadows and to be in the light. I feel strong because we had the Chamber of Commerce there and we have Republicans and Democrats on the stage here tonight, because we have groups like Maldef, who are fighting the good fight, and Asian Americans advancing justice, and those groups like AJC who realized that this isn't just an attack on dreamers. And let's not just make this about dreamers. There are 11 million other immigrants here who don't qualify for DACA, whose fates we need to resolve too. Let us explode the myth of those who want to divide us and want us to divide each other. We can't afford that. We can't afford to yell at one another, and we can't afford to buy into the myths that somehow out there, there are American-born people who dream, as our Attorney General said, whose dreams matter too, as if they are different from the dreamers. They aren't they are us. I had a reporter just interview me and say, at my station, I didn't realize we had some DACA recipients who today told me that was their status and spoke of their fear. In my office, where we have dreamers who work, on the payroll of the city of Los Angeles proudly, we know that these are great Americans. So 6 months to get our work done. But this city will defend and protect every dreamer in this city, not share their information, provide them with the safe spaces in our schools and our public facilities. And our challenge today, let me end with this, is to find again our stories. For those of you that are in here as Jews, we can tell those stories because we know what this is like. We know what it's like when the small bits of legislation or executive action begin to constrain and confine us and push us. And for those of us who are Latinos, and thank you to our Consul General of Mexico who is here today, we know what it feels like to be scapegoated in this country as well, to be told that we're the reason why people are not working, or that we're the reason why wages are low, when study after study shows when dreamers are pushed back in the shadows, it depresses the wages of native-born Americans. It's logical, right? When you compete against somebody who now has to work under the table for less than minimum wage, your wages go down too. So be strong, Los Angeles. My commitment is not just to this city, but across this country, to join the mayors and cities of this nation together as we have been doing, to challenge our national leaders. If the president won't do it, then Congress must. And each and every one of us has to know that if they don't deliver, that extremists of any party, but extremists especially of Republicans of the right wing who will say, we want to take away your health care, and our agenda is to make sure that we do nothing about global warming, and that we want the dreamers to go back into the shadows, they will pay when it comes to election day. AJC is a nonpartisan, bipartisan group, but I can say that as mayor. I can say that we're coming after you if you don't take care of our dreamers. Enough talk, it's time for action, and this city of angels will wrap our wings around all the dreamers. Thank you very much.
So Mayor Eric Garcetti began his remarks by talking about this as a day of darkness. And what I've learned over the course of my life is that when you face darkness, you walk toward the light. And you turn to frightened people on either side of you. And you lead them forward to that light.
LA is not sanctuary city.
But before you can lead those frightened people to the light, you need to be as informed and as educated and as prepared as possible. And so we've put together a panel discussion tonight to talk about this important challenge of making sure our immigrant communities are safe. I'll introduce each of our panelists individually in just a moment, but please join me in welcoming them collectively because we're very, very grateful to have each of these fine men and women with us here this evening. Thank you so much. So in just a moment, I'm going to begin the questioning of our panelists. But I do want to take a minute to make sure, while I think most of you recommend the array of intelligence and skill and experience we have before us tonight, I want to take just a moment to make sure all of us understand how lucky we are to have these individuals with us. Sitting to my immediate left is my friend Tom Sines. And for those of you who might not know Tom, he is not only a nationally recognized civil rights attorney, and he was not only counsel to Mayor Antonio Villaraigosa, but he is, of course, currently the president and general counsel for the Mexican American Legal Defense and Education Foundation, and one of the smartest and bravest people who I have the privilege of knowing. Tom Sines, thank you for being here with us tonight. Sitting next to Tom is our friend, Los Angeles County Sheriff Jim McDonnell. Sheriff McDonnell is the 32nd Sheriff of Los Angeles County. He served for no fewer than 29 years at the Los Angeles Police Department, where he held every rank from police officer to second in command to Chief Bill Bratton. He created the blueprint for LAPD's community-based policing efforts, and he too is one of the smartest and bravest people I know. Sheriff Jim McDonnell, thank you so much for being here. Cindy Chang is a respected journalist who has covered Los Angeles and the surrounding communities for the Los Angeles Times. She currently covers the Los Angeles Police Department, but she's been to the Times for more than 5 years, covering immigration and ethnic communities before coming to the Sheriff's Beat. Previously, she wrote for the New Orleans Times-Picayune, where she was the lead writer on a series of Louisiana prisons that won several national awards. One of the most respected journalists here in LA or anywhere else, Cindy Chang. Cindy, thank you so much. And last and certainly not least, it's my privilege to introduce to you Deputy Chief of the Los Angeles Police Department, Horace Frank. Chief Frank began his career as a police officer in 1998, almost 20 years ago. He's worked on counterterrorism, special operations. He's been an academic instructor at the LAPD Department Academy, and a staff writer at the Human Resources Bureau, and he's attended and instructed at numerous national leadership schools, including the FBI National Academy. Once again, one of the best that Los Angeles has to offer. Chief Frank, so much to you to be here with us tonight. So as our President Scott Edelman mentioned, even though tonight's discussion is primarily about the question and the challenges of providing public safety and law enforcement for immigrant communities, we'd be remiss if we didn't spend at least a couple of minutes at the outset of this discussion talking about the news of the day, that of course being the Trump administration's announcement on DACA. And I'm going to ask a couple of our panelists to offer some thoughts on this briefly, and then we will move on to the law enforcement and public safety discussion that was originally advertised. So Tom, I'm going to come to you, and he tells me that his day started at 5 o'clock this morning. I think he's being modest. My guess is it started several hours before that, because this is the kind of day where people like Tom rise to the occasion and we're lucky to have him. Mayor Garcetti talked about this dark day, and I talked a little bit about the light going forward. If you can, help us understand what the path forward can look like and what it should look like over the next 6 months.
Well, as the mayor indicated, we need Congress to act. This is a Congress that, unfortunately, to date has demonstrated little ability to accomplish anything. But what we saw today was an astounding demonstration of weak leadership from Donald Trump to cave in to empty, disingenuous threats of legal action from the state of Texas and 8 others, to do so on the basis of faulty and biased legal advice. This is an initiative that would have been very defensible in court, putting at risk hundreds of thousands of very strong contributors to our economy and our community across the country. It lays down the gauntlet for the Congress to do what it needs to do and do it quickly. What we need is for Congress to step out of character, directly address the issue that is of such concern to so many, from leadership like the mayor here, from business leaders in the tech sector and beyond, from communities that understand the leadership potential today and in the future of this cohort of immigrants. We need them to enact the DREAM Act immediately.
So Cindy, I'm going to come to you as someone who has covered immigrant communities here in Los Angeles and the surrounding area. What we've heard from Tom and what we've heard from the mayor is the political path forward, what Congress needs to do, should do, and will do. But if you can, as someone who's covered these communities, who knows these communities, talk about the impact of an announcement like that in these neighborhoods for individuals, either themselves, who are dreamers and affected by the decision, by the announcement today, or those who know and love those individuals.
So, you know, I'm sure you all know it's hard enough to be a young person, and, you know, for these young people to finally have the opportunity to have a job, and many of them, you know, have found great jobs, and all of a sudden now their future is unknown. I mean, obviously that's a huge blow. And a lot of them really have overcome so much to be where they are today. And, you know, and it's just got to really strike fear in the hearts of people who are already afraid, because, you know, these are their model citizens, the most sympathetic of this group of immigrants, and now they're being targeted. So, I mean, but these are strong people, so I'm sure that they will be doing their best to move forward and make the best lives for themselves and their families, but it has to be a difficult day for them.
Cindy, thank you very much. Deputy Chief Frank, let me come to you as we move the conversation from today's news to the topic around which tonight's program was originally designed. Cindy mentioned frightened people. And one of the ways of protecting a community, any community, is reassuring frightened people that they shouldn't be afraid. Talk about the role that you play and that the LAPD plays in these communities to build relationships to lessen that level of fear.
Well, within the Los Angeles Police Department, within law enforcement in general, I think we play an extremely important role in terms of reducing that fear amongst communities, not just immigrant communities, but all communities. Of paramount importance, the fact that we need to develop the kind of relationships within communities where they feel empowered and they feel that they've got a trusting relationship within law enforcement. It is pretty difficult for us to have that kind of relationship where the communities have enveloped and developed that kind of trust in law enforcement. It's pretty difficult for us to establish that when members of communities, be it immigrant communities or otherwise, don't feel comfortable in approaching law enforcement for fear that their approach or their cooperation with us is going to become, or their immigrant status will become a bone of contention, where they feel that when they come to us, and we're going to start looking at their immigrant status. That's a pretty tough road to follow, and I think it's important that the message that we get out to communities is that, which is the same message that we in the Los Angeles Police Department have been embracing since go all the way back to 1979, as the mayor talked about with Special Order Number 40, where our position is that we will not take any enforcement action against anyone solely based on their immigration status. And I think that's a message that we have to keep putting out there over and over again.
Thank you, Chief Frank. Sheriff McDonald, let me come to you. The chief mentioned the importance of building trust between law enforcement and the communities they serve. Maybe you can talk a little bit about how your department works to build that trust, what has been accomplished, and what's still to be done.
Well, thank you, Dan. Certainly, I'll echo Chief Frank's comments as it relates to trust is the currency of our profession. If we don't have trust, we don't have much else. And so we've worked very hard in Los Angeles to be able to overcome some very strong feelings of distrust with many of our communities over the last 36 years that I've been involved in law enforcement in Los Angeles. We have come a long way. We still have a long way to go, and we can never check the box and say we've done. We've accomplished that. Every day is a work in progress, but every day is an opportunity for us to earn that trust, and trust is earned, certainly. When I look at where we are today, as Chief Frank mentioned, Special Order 40 going back to 1979, we are the same. We do not stop anybody to determine their immigration status. We don't ask about immigration status at any point during the contact, or even if there's arrest made. That's not part of what we do. And to be able to reassure the community, because the anxiety level, the fear level is very high, and we understand that. So we want to be able to move forward. Every chance we get to speak to community groups, we do that. We have each one of our employees in our organization, and policing is an ambassador for the mission that we do. Our communities can only be safe if we all work together. When I look at the number of people across this country who are full-time police, it's probably 800,000, 900,000, serving a population of 325 million. When you do the math on that, that's about 1/3 of 1% of our population are charged with the safety of the remainder of the population. The numbers are clearly too small for us to be able to take on that mission on our own. We have to work together. We have to have an engaged community, and one that feels comfortable approaching the police if they're a victim of a crime or a witness to a crime. That is how our system works, and really that's the only way that we can expect to feel safe in our homes, our kids in their schools, and to be able to move forward productively as a society.
Sheriff, thank you very much. And I'll take a moment now before we go on with the questioning to let all of you know that in about 10 minutes, we'll be collecting cards from as many of you as possible with questions that you would like to have asked of one or more of our panelists. You should have those cards on or next to your seats, and we'd ask you to spend a little bit of time as this conversation continues to write down questions that you think would help and it would benefit the conversation. And in about 10 minutes or so, we'll come and pick those cards up. So Tom, let me come back to you. What are the next steps that should be taken to build the kind of trust that the chief and sheriff talk about? What can local law enforcement be doing? We'll talk about the federal role in just a minute. What else can local law enforcement be doing? And what else can we be looking for from the communities and their leaders to help build that stronger trust?
Well, I think we need to have a debate about criminal justice in this country that is not diverted by discussion of immigration, which is to say, too often we miss critical issues of criminal justice policy when often political leaders focus on using the immigration system somehow as an adjunct of criminal justice. It doesn't work. And it extends beyond simply the very strong policies we've heard articulated here out in the field not being involved in immigration enforcement. But I am a strong advocate for a strict separation of immigration enforcement and local law enforcement at every level. That is not to say that local law enforcement doesn't have to deal and appropriately deal with certain issues that overlap with immigration. A couple of examples. Clearly, we want our local police and sheriffs to address issues of human trafficking. We want them to address issues of human exploitation. But that's not being involved in immigration enforcement, and it doesn't help to have there be any involvement in immigration enforcement. I would also say that the T and U visa programs are critical, and that we need police departments and sheriff's offices that use those visa programs to ensure that they are cooperating with the community and that witnesses and victims who may lack status have the ability to participate in ensuring that those who exploit them, those who victimize them, are appropriately punished. But the problem comes when we talk about using the immigration system, the immigration enforcement system, as an adjunct of criminal justice. When we talk about deporting, removing those who have been accused or convicted of crimes, because that diverts us from discussing the issues that are at bottom criminal justice issues that apply to everyone, citizen or immigrant. I believe that we would be better off if together, law enforcement and the community, agreed that a strict separation means that in our criminal justice system, from beginning to end, we treat every person accused of a crime, whether citizen or immigrant, exactly the same. No distinction. Because when we do that, we can focus on what are the underlying issues that impact the citizen accused as well as the immigrant. But when we focus on deportation as a tool of criminal justice, we miss the commonality between an immigrant recidivist and a citizen recidivist. The example, of course, would be the regrettable and tragic murder of Kate Steinle. Instead of focusing on what the real issues there were, and there were many, starting with the availability of the weapon, where it was, starting with the lack of policing of what was going on in the vicinity, completing the equation relating to some of the other criminal justice issues related to what the accused had done previously. Instead, we got politicians who claimed this was a problem with sanctuary cities. We've got to use removal and deportation as a tool of criminal justice. But if you looked at the details, it should have told us this is not an appropriate tool. If you look at the reasons we have a criminal justice system, the Steinle case demonstrates that they don't work. Starting with incapacitation, we put people in jail to prevent them from being on the streets and committing a crime. If we treat deportation as somehow incapacitating, we are wrong. The Steinle case indicates that. Despite the best patrolled border we've had in decades, literally decades, the individual is able to come back to this country 4 or 5 times. It doesn't incapacitate. The others, deterrence, I don't think it deters anyone when they can cross, be deported, and then they're able to return even with the best patrolled border we've ever had. Rehabilitation, it's clearly nothing rehabilitative about removing someone from this country. Retribution, does the victim feel better that someone was deported and removed when that person can return? When you look at it from the perspective of the reasons we have a criminal justice system, using deportation and removal as a part of it simply fails on every count. Instead, we should focus on the underlying issues that affect those who are accused and recidivists who are citizens as well as those who are immigrants. No distinction between the two.
So Chief Frank, what Tom just expressed very articulately.